You're having lunch with friends, comparing what folks brought. It seems like everybody wants what someone else has. Maybe people suggest trades. One person swaps their potato chips for some cookies. But is that guaranteed to work? Will everybody end up happy with what they have? What could have made this scenario easier? After discussing all those important economic indicators, in this unit, we're focusing on money, the fuel for the engine of economic growth. In this unit, we'll cover some basic characteristics of money, the role of banks, how money fuels economic expansion, and the role of monetary policy in keeping that growth on track. Now, in our snack scenario, people would have bartered as a way to get the snack they wanted. Barter is the exchange of goods and services without using money, trading goods and services for other goods and services. Now, bartering might work well when you want to trade snacks. It even works in small towns or places that are harder to access. But what happens if you try it on a large scale? Well, it makes trade more complex and time-consuming. For example, you may have a donut but are in the mood for pretzels. But if the person with pretzels wants an orange, then first you have to find someone with an orange who is willing to trade for a donut. Could you imagine working, renting an apartment, buying a car, and paying for groceries if you had to set up dozens of different trades just to get the basic necessities? Money, on the other hand, makes trade easier and quicker. If you have a dollar, you can pay the person for their pretzels. Then that individual is free to do whatever they want with that dollar. And for those bigger, more complex transactions, money makes it even smoother. Need to buy new shoes? All you need to do is hand over some money. Now, we do need to make sure we're crystal clear about what we mean when we talk about money. Money is a broad term referring to a system of value, not necessarily tangible, that makes trade and other financial transactions easier. This includes currency, as well as money stored in bank accounts. Currency is a tangible form of money, like paper bills and coins. Let's take a moment to check in. One of your friends is setting up a social media group where people can trade with other members of the community to take care of their wants and needs. They think this group has real potential. What would you say to your friend? Take a moment to record your answer in the PDF, and we'll meet back here in a moment. Okay, so you probably told your friend that this might not be the best idea because barter makes trade more difficult and time-consuming. Using money would probably be a better way. Let's say you need to grab a few things from different stores. You need cookies for the potluck dinner you're attending later this week, and a birthday card for a friend. Plus, you need to pay part of your cell phone bill. You can use one of three things to pay for all of this: a $500 bill from a board game your family plays, a gold bar, or a $100 bill. Which one is the best choice, and what's your rationale? Pause the video for a moment to record your answer. Okay, I bet you chose the $100 bill, and that was a great choice. But let's talk about why it was such a good choice. You see, there are six characteristics of money that make it effective for trade. We've included a graphic organizer in the PDF to help you take notes for this section. First, it has to be acceptable. That means that people who conduct financial transactions all agree on its value and are willing to take it as payment. So that eliminates the board game money. It should also be portable or easy to carry. Let's face it, lugging around a gold bar that weighs almost 30 pounds is, shall we say, suboptimal. Money should also be divisible, meaning it can be broken down into smaller units. A dollar can be broken down into 4 quarters, a quarter into 2 dimes and a nickel into 5 pennies. If you pay for something with that $100 bill, you'll get change back. It's going to be kind of hard to do that with a gold bar. Money should also be scarce, meaning there is a limited amount of it. The gold bar is worth so much because gold is a scarce commodity. And while there may be more $100 bills out there, it isn't like there is an endless supply of them. That scarcity is what gives money its purchasing power. Money should also be durable, able to last a long time. That $100 bill, it might be a crisp new one, or it might be several years old, but it does last. I mean, money doesn't just disintegrate when it gets wet. And finally, the value and purchasing power of money should be stable. While prices might increase due to inflation, they generally don't rise so quickly as to make that $100 bill worthless. Sure, you may have to pay more for those cookies in a year, but they aren't going to cost over $100. Okay, if you look below the graphic organizer, we've given you a place to revise and refine your answer to the question about how you would pay for the things you want to buy. Pause the video to finish that and make sure you have your graphic organizer completed. Our comparison of a gold bar and a $100 bill brings up a really important distinction between different types of money. On the one hand, we have commodity money, like the gold bar. Commodity money is currency that has value because it is made out of a valuable material, such as a precious metal. Now, this type of currency is great because it is stable in value, which means less fluctuation in purchasing power. But the amount of money circulating in an economy and its total value depends on how much of that valuable material a person, business, or nation controls. If money is based on gold, and you don't have a lot of gold, well, you just don't have a lot of money. And would it be easy to get more gold? Fiat money, on the other hand, is currency that has value because a government declares it to be legal tender and is accepted for goods and services. That $100 bill is worth $100 because the government has declared that is acceptable for all debts, public and private. That means that it can pay for the things you need in a store. This type of money is great because it allows for greater investment and economic growth because it isn't limited by how much of a precious material is controlled. But it is less stable and more prone to fluctuations in purchasing power. And because this money's value can be impacted by government actions, it works best for nations that are stable politically and economically. Let's take a moment to check in. Your friend's grandfather is a real pirate enthusiast. He wonders why countries ever moved away from gold doubloons as currency. What would you say to him? Pause the video to answer, and we'll check back in. So, when talking with your friend's grandfather, you may want to discuss that while gold coins are stable in value, they limit how much wealth a person or nation can accumulate. Fiat money might be less stable and fluctuate in value more, but it does allow for greater investment and economic growth. Okay, let's take a second to recap what we've covered today. While it is possible to barter in order to obtain those goods and services we want and need, money actually makes it much easier and quicker. The reason money makes trade easier is because it is acceptable, portable, divisible, scarce, durable, and stable. We also discuss the differences between commodity money and fiat money. Tomorrow, we're going to take a deeper look at banks, those institutions that make working with money even easier. But until then, remember to keep investing in yourself, one lesson at a time. See you next time. Hey.